Yes, welcome one and all to this fortnight's spooktastic installment of everybody's favourite fear-inducing horror fest that is Channelglazes. It's almost Halloween, don't you know, so I've prepped some horrible surprises for our little dwarves, oh ho ho, yes. The first of which is forgetting I left the civilians in the burrows whilst I was winding down from last episode. So now they're having an unsanctioned relaxation session. Yes, that's right, Mr. Thumbs. I should probably explain. Mr. Thumbs is a soundboard budgerigar. I'm bird-sitting for the weekend. Daddy Snod had to go looking for a new job, didn't he, Mr. Thumbs? Yes, such a pretty bird. Pretty bird. Oh, no, I don't like that. Anyway, back to Channelglazes. The civilians got off easy. I'll soon discover our warriors of the mysterious tongs all stood to attention in their barracks, half-starved and spitting feathers. I say soon, I mean a few months. Little harsh, but it's fine. They're fine. They will be fine. Moving on, we had a teeny tiny migrant wave consisting of these two, Libash and Lawbam. Oh, that's going to get old fast! Off they go anyway, making themselves useful. Hello, Lukey. How's that hand doing? Everybody's favourite human bard spends quite a lot of time in the temple, to be honest. Really should nip that worship of false idols in the bud. Talking of nipping buds, take a look at these leaf-munching little beasts. The mother appears to have... passed on. That is to say that she's a ghost, yes. Ooh, spooky. Oh, come on, you stupid bird, work with me. We've decided to name them Reg and Nell. And I plan to get the dwarves to train them up as horrifying weapons of war. Or pets, I don't know. Ah, yes, our resident monster hunters. Sharing thrilling tales of... Oh... My. Me. Look. It happened. Emtha and Ngojo are lovers.
I love you, sugar.
Shh. That's right, Mr. Thumbs. Incredibly unsettling, but absolutely right. Spooky. Yes. Absolutely nothing scarier than a new relationship. All that swapping of bodily fluids and commitment. Oh, damn the season of the witch. I can't pretend to be anything but excited. Just think, we may soon have a clutch of human eggs, and not long after, a flock of little babies. Oh, which reminds me, we should probably start making the cages. I learned my lesson from Col-Col. I'm not having all the dwarves' time taken up by hauling the kiddies' cloacal condiments. And Emtha is singing. Now, if that were Durr, it would fit the season. Hehe. I'm so happy for our little lovebirds. And here's another thing to be happy about. It's Queen Ervad! She's on Thycut's trail, which will take her off course onto our industrial level, as our expedition leader has been burning wood. But it won't take her long to get to the office. There we go. The world is the same as ever. Spooky, you mean? yes. We're going to ask for some clothing this year. Just chest coverings, as we've been making our own silken cat trousers for a while now. Owen drinks, though honestly, I just add them to ask for something nowadays. Crossbows for relics, Shimmered. No, they must have started up the hurling contests again. Now that is truly terrifying. Best of luck, Your Highness. Off to the tavern, then you're... Oh. No, the temple. No. Straight out of the fortress. Ha. Huh. Wonder what her problem was. On to the trading. Ah, bloody bird. You can't do that, Mr. Thumbs. Where was I? Ah, yes, trading. And I've asked the dwarves to start bringing some odds and sods to sell. A little bit of a mishmash, as our stocks are low on trading goods. State of our stockpiles is the real horror story here. Spooky. Oh no, look at these little idiots. We've got the mysterious tongs off duty after their 3-month standing to attention ordeal, and so they've popped their armour onto the stands in the barracks. Which is causing the civilian dwarves to relocate the pieces to the armour stockpile, which in turn makes the warriors rush to the stockpile to re-outfit the stands. This is a well-known bug in the Dwarf Fortress community, and seeing as they're slow enough without wearing armour everywhere, I'm probably just going to delete the stockpiles. This is what happens when your civilization runs on alcohol. Ridiculous. Oh, what a failure of trading this is! 5 bags of seeds and a handful of duck eggs. Oh, ignore the grackle. Turns out the tiny little bird is too much for the caravan's decrepit old horse to wangle weight-wise. Ugh, I'll have to dig up some more quality merchandise. Spooky. Here's something that I've been teasing for a while. Just south of the temple, we now have 2 little areas set up for our beastmen pairs. Dingo and Skink, respectively. I did mess the design up somewhat. The rooms were supposed to be taller, with the bedrooms hidden off much further below. But it doesn't really matter. They've got beds in their little private areas, so they can get to know their little private areas. And if it ever becomes clear that they need to eat and drink, we can drop them sustenance from above. We will need to beware with the skinks. It turns out they can climb up walls, but the dingoes should be fine, and we may even be able to use them as... pest removal? Uh-oh! Shh! Uh-oh indeed, Mr. Thumbs. Look! Low Gem has withdrawn from society. I was wondering when my tinkering would take effect. He'll have been feeling the change happening over the last few moons. Losing want for trivial things like bread and wine. Drawn instead to the prepared innards. Feasting on flesh, his tastes darken ruby red until now. Now he looks to his fellow dwarf with a hideous hunger, but disgusted with himself, he turns away and... What's he doing? Oh, for the love of me, he's just working? Ah, false alarm. Sorry, everyone. I guess we'll cut back when he's done. And here it is, Nemadabia, a large cut gem. Whoopee! No, oh, sorry, no, perfect fortification agate. That is encrusted with radiant cut fortification agate. Yo, Dingo, I heard you like gems. Am I right? Anyway. I guess it's pretty enough, so we'll forge up a gold pedestal and display it in the temple. Yes, there we go. Just nobody tell Eggman. One giant hedgehog is enough for this series, thank you. Oh, would you look at the lovebirds? I do hope everything is still going well for them. I keep meaning to change Ungojo's bedroom so they're sharing the love jug. Yuck! Come now, Mr. Thumbs. The name is a little off-putting, but the sentiment behind it is adorable. Yuck! No, there's no pleasing sub-budgies. We'll see you two later, anyway. Try not to get into any trouble. I've decided we'll take a look into what our broker is up to. For no particular reason. Yes, indeed, nothing supernatural going on here. She's burning wood right now. Much like everybody else in the fortress, she's become very proficient at burning wood. We're still creating glass blocks, you see, and if you'll remember, the process involves a lot of burning wood, so... yes. But Rimtar isn't bothered by the extra work. She's an incredibly dependable dwarf, though not in a fight. Pusillanimous, unfortunately. Oh, where is she going? Off to haul that big hunk of limonite? Aha! Watch now, as she bursts forth with unnatural super dwarven strength, tossing the boulder as though it were a mere pebble and... What? Why is she going so slowly? Oh, it's not working! Why is it not working? Oh, I may as well come clean. I wanted to have a really exciting, horror-filled episode for Halloween. So I took a trip back to the dimension of Destiny's primordial soup and added a hard buzz of Worcestershire sauce. I was sure we'd be up to our eyebrows in werebeasts and vampires by now. So disappointing. Oh yes, that's right, Mr. Thumbs. Oh well. On to the everyday workings of the fortress, I guess. Here's something I mentioned I'd sought last episode. A new barracks for the barricaded pools, which just so happens to be a squad made up of all the fort's administrators. Oh, and Kolkol, always best to keep her busy. I've lined it with bookcases to make them feel at home, and we'll be adding tables and chairs once the dwarves carve some up. I figure it can pull double duty as a library. Catton is the squad leader. Despite what I think of her, it's still impossible to not acknowledge her prowess and leadership qualities. Plus, making her head of the pen pushers is the snubbiest snub I can think of. She has, of course, taken to it with gusto and is performing admirably, because she's a git. Mr. Thumbs? What are you... Oh no! Giant buzzards! They're heading in! Okay, we had you all training for this. Come on, mysterious tongs! Oh me, look at the size of them! The animals have all fled their pasture. Should probably get walls up. And here they come! Oh, they're absolutely destroying them! Go, my beautiful dwarves! There's one left. I've sent the warriors the kill command, and no amount of being a big feathery bastard will save it from their ironclad grasp. Way, they did it! And look, the hospital is empty, because there's nary a scratch upon a one of them. I'd say this calls for a celebration. What do you say to a drink, Mr. Thumbs? I'll take that as a yes. Oh, 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 yes! See, I knew they could do it. It's spring now, and with how much the dwarves have done, I think they've more than earned a little rest. So with the kitchen stockpile fully stocked, we've switched the burrows on, and we'll let the little beauties get some well-deserved rest. Yes, Mr. Thumbs, such a pretty bird. You know, while the dwarves relax, I think it's high time I got a few things off my chest. I tend to bite my toenails, I often pick my nose. I wait till you're not looking, then I wipe it on your clothes. I chew with my mouth open and I wear too much cologne. I always turn loudspeaker on when answering the phone. I wear ladies' underwear. Mr. Thumbs! Locking me out was bad enough, but what on earth are you singing about?
Loser!
Did Snotford get you to do this?
Bingo!
bingo.
I'm going to bloody kill him, but not before you. Get here, you nasty little... Snodford, you filthy little hobgoblin. I'm going to get you back for this. Get back here, you flappy little sod. Well, what an absolute disaster that was. No, before we get to the end of the episode proper, I just had to share this little moment of Cubuck, the only dwarven child at the fortress, playing in buffalo vomit on the surface. His parents must be so proud. Oh, and additionally, in all the excitement with Mr. Thumbs, I didn't get to mention the fact that our two thrips, Reg and Nell, appear to have disappeared. I didn't ask anyone to train them, didn't get chance. So I asked the dwarves to remove the cage, which they did, dumping it where it is now, inches from where it was. Bloody dwarves. But yes, I'm wrapping this episode up. As always, it has been my pleasure to entertain you. Keep yourselves safe in this world gone mad, and I shall see you next time. Anus Eshon, you wonderful individuals. Anus Eshon. Oh, come on, Flimmerfee, it was just a joke. Yes, at my expense. You've got to learn a laugh for yourself. It was in my video. I'm sure it'll get you loads of comments and likes, though. But I told you those things in confidence.